Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Today we will study about three spirits that are called as Spirit of God. Then born of the Spirit, and then baptism of the Holy Ghost. First, about the three spirits of God. They are, number one, the one and only Spirit who has the omnipotent powers, and He is God. The omnipowers are omnipotence, omnipresence, and omniscience. Three souls are in this omnipotent Spirit, and they are also God because they are part of this Spirit. Number two, the Holy Ghost is one of the three souls in God, in that omnipotent Spirit. A soul is a person, and so the Holy Ghost is a person. A soul is not a spirit, even though it is like a spirit. However, God refers him as the Spirit of God. And number three, the Holy Spirit is also the Spirit of God. Please notice, the Holy Spirit is not the Holy Ghost. Both are different. God gives the Holy Spirit as a gift to people to make their soul alive spiritually. It is also called the Spirit of Man, since it is given to man, and it will be an integral part of a born-again person. This Spirit is a creation of God, but even Bible scholars say that the Holy Ghost is the Holy Spirit, and they are wrong. All the above three spirits are referred as the Spirit of God. If we pay attention to the context that is used, then we will not make a mistake, we'll find out. The context will reveal which one it is. Let us see the only omnipotent Spirit. God is one Spirit who has three souls or persons in Him. John chapter 4 verse 24 says, God is a Spirit. So God is one Spirit, and He is omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient, and these three are His power attributes. God is omnipotent according to Job chapter 42 verse 2, Book of Psalms chapter 147 verse 5, Book of Revelation chapter 19 verse 6, and some other verses also. Absolutely nothing is impossible to Him. He has created all things, from an invisible atom to the stars much larger than the sun. God is omnipresent according to Book of Psalms 135 verse 6 and 139 verse 7 and 8. So He fills the entire universe at any time. God is omniscient, and according to Job 26 verse 6 and 36 verse 21 and 22, Book of Psalms 139 verse 4. So He knows everything, even He knows what we think. Nothing is hidden from Him. So with the omnipowers of His Spirit, He is God. According to Genesis chapter 1 verse 1, Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 4, 1 Kings chapter 8 verse 60, the New Testament, Mark chapter 12 verse 32, John chapter 4 verse 24, and 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 4, and He is one God. He says one God. God is one, and He is one Spirit. This Spirit is considered as the body of God, like we have a body, and it is His body. And He is also called as the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is common to these three spirits, and one is this. The Spirit, as God's body, holds three souls, and the souls are also called God because they are part of the omnipotent Spirit of God. However, the soul, the Most High, is also a soul as a person, or God the Father, is considered as the prime person in the body of God. And the other two souls, the Word and the Holy Ghost, are subject to him. The next is the Holy Ghost, and this is also called as Spirit of God. The Holy Ghost is one of the souls or person in God. He is also nested with the other two souls in the omnipotent spirit body of God. And so he is also God. Genesis chapter 1 verse 2 says, "And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters." So he is also the Spirit of God, and he took part in creation. The Holy Ghost did the ministry of God in the Old Testament as well as in the New Testament. In Genesis chapter 41 verse 38, Pharaoh said unto his servants, "Can we find such a one as this, a man in whom the Spirit of God is?" That is the interpretation of the dreams of Pharaoh, the wisdom of God that is revealed in Pharaoh through Joseph, and the fulfillment of them all are the works of the Holy Ghost in the Old Testament, and he was known as the Spirit of God. In Matthew chapter 12 verse 28, Jesus says, "But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you." It is the Holy Ghost, and he was referred as the Spirit of God in the New Testament also. Matthew chapter 3 verse 16 says, "And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him." Here, the word "the Spirit of God" refers to the Holy Ghost descending upon Jesus, and he abides in him, as well as he lights the entire Holy Spirit, which was the first day creation. It was light, the first day God created light, and light is this Holy Spirit. And he lights that whole entire light, which is the Holy Spirit, into Jesus Christ. That is, the Holy Ghost made Jesus as the custodian of the Holy Spirit by lighting the Spirit into Jesus. The Holy Spirit is also called light, and as the Spirit of men also. Now let's see about this Holy Spirit. This Spirit is the third part of a born-again person. If you are born again, we have the Holy Spirit in us. That's the third part. First, we are the body, flesh, and the soul is the one. And then this is the Spirit, is the third part. Jesus Christ gives the Holy Spirit to repentant people. And if they will ask him, so that they may live a holy life. That's in Luke chapter 11 verse 13. It says, "If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them they ask him?" The receiving of the Holy Spirit is referred as born again or born of the Spirit. This Holy Spirit is also referred to as the Spirit of God. It's in Romans chapter 8, verse 14, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11 and verse 14, and chapter 12, verse 3, Book of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, and 1 John chapter 4, verse 2 also. The Holy Spirit is not God, and he is called the Holy Spirit because he is a spirit, and then he will lead the people to holy life, and he is also holy. That's why he is called Holy Spirit, but he is not God. The Spirit is weak, and he is like a candle when compared to the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost or God compared to the intensity and brightness of the sun. And the Holy Spirit is compared to the candle light in comparison. So that much weak. So he's not God, he's just a spirit. And he's given to a man. And and he may be even quenched by men. This spirit is also called as the spirit of man also in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 11, since it is given to man. Christians think that the spirit is God. They often are confused with the Holy Spirit with the Holy Ghost. Preachers and Bible teachers make the same mistake because they do not study the Bible, but they study the books of theologians. Even if we showed it to them, most of them will not accept it. They adamantly hold on to their belief. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 13 and 14 say, after that you believed, you are sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance. The Holy Spirit will be sealed unto us. It is given to us and stamped into us as if we are led by the Spirit. If we are led by the Spirit, then it is a promise of inheritance in heaven, in the kingdom of God, if we have the Holy Spirit in us, if we receive that. If not, there's no heavenly inheritance for us. The Holy Spirit will not push us around where He wanted us to go. He won't dictate us. He won't demand. He will not behave as a master, but He will behave as a guide. He will lead us and guide us. If you want to go, He will lead us. Otherwise, He will leave us alone. We should not grieve or quench the Holy Spirit, as in Ephesians chapter 4 verse 30 and in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 19. The Holy Spirit is a part of a born again man. If we're not born again, we don't have the Holy Spirit in us. But the Holy Ghost is God. And God has breathed the same Holy Spirit into Adam as a part of him at creation. That's in Genesis chapter 2 verse 7. The Holy Spirit is referred as the Spirit of God, even in Job chapter 27 verse 3 and Romans chapter 8 verse 9. And Romans chapter 8 verse 9 say, Romans chapter 8 verse 9, but you are not in the flesh but in the Spirit, so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Here, the Holy Spirit is also called as Spirit of God and is also called as the Spirit of Christ. The next is baptized with the Holy Ghost and filled with the Holy Ghost. And both words are used. First time, it says baptized with the Holy Ghost, and after that, every time it's filled with the Holy Ghost. That's the terminology used in the scripture. The baptism of the Holy Ghost is a very controversial subject among denominational Christians. One side, people think that it is to speak in tongues, and so they learn to utter some meaningless syllables and call it as baptism of the Holy Ghost. It is ignorance, and that creates a counterfeit, and it'll create fake things. So we'll be vulnerable to the deception. On the other hand, people get smart and wise and think that the Holy God will not manifest speaking in meaningless syllables, so they're smarter than, I don't know. And so they call it as manifestations of the demons and devils. These people commit blasphemy against God, and they will go to hell for it. It will be better for them if they are not smart. Be ordinary persons. Don't be smart, Alex. Some people get excited. This is another branch. Emotional and acts like an insane maniac. They run around and they make a lot of noise, commotion. And as if they are as a drunk people and do wild things and call it as a baptism of the Holy Ghost. I don't know how. Mostly, it's all a mess. But the Bible talks about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Baptism of the Holy Ghost is true and real. Let us see what the Bible says. John the Baptist says in Matthew chapter 3, verse 11, I indeed baptize you with the water into repentance, but He that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Jesus Christ, the one who's going to baptize you. John the Baptist points out that Jesus Christ will baptize people with the Holy Ghost. Most of all, Jesus Christ tells his disciples, not to begin the ministry without the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Don't go without it. That's what he says. That's in Acts chapter 1, verse 4 and 5. Acts chapter 1, verse 4 and 5. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart Jerusalem, depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, you have heard of me. Because Jesus told them even before, you have heard of me before, now I'm telling again, don't leave Jerusalem without the Holy Spirit. Don't leave without it. Verse 5, John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Jesus Christ told this. And the disciples, they did not depart Jerusalem and waited until they received the baptism. Then only they started the ministry. The ministry began after the baptism of the Holy Spirit. There's no ministry of Jesus Christ without the baptism of the Holy Ghost. But highly educated theologians and have ministries, very high caliber, and they're not of Jesus Christ. Because that's their own. They started by themselves, I think. Those ministries are of religion and they're of the world. And those ministries do not belong to Jesus Christ, because they didn't follow Jesus. Whatever Jesus said, they ignored it. They're smarter than Jesus. Let's see Simon Peter. Simon Peter in Acts chapter 11. Verses 15. And as I began to speak, Peter saying, the Holy Ghost fell on them as on us at the beginning. Verse 16. Then remembered I the word of the Lord, how that he said, John indeed baptized with the water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Verse 17. For as much then as God gave them the like gift as he did unto us, who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God? So God is the one doing it. This is for Gentiles. Apostle Peter recognized the manifestation of God, and it was identical to the baptism of the Holy Ghost, which they gave in the for the 120 people from the upper room. So it is identical as given to the Gentiles also. And he called this action of God. God did it. Theologians call them the action of the devil. This is the devil of the demons. That's what they say. Famous preachers. If I tell the names, you'll know. But many of them, not only one or two. Many of the famous preachers, they call these manifestations as that of the devil. God is true, and these people are liars, and they are children of the devil. It is sad. But the Holy Ghost gives the gifts and power of God to the chosen people of God, and it is like an ordination to do the ministry. He said, without this, don't go. So wait until you receive it, and then start your ministry. That's a command of Jesus Christ. Well, you started without it. Just because you go and got a degree from theology school, that won't qualify by Jesus. It's qualified by your mission, yes, by the denominations, but it's not of Jesus Christ. So this experience ceremonially is called the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Actually, it is an ordination by God to the people. He sent the people by ordaining them and giving them gifts. It is of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in many places that the Spirit of God came upon them or filled them. It may be just to give gifts to them or to give boldness to them in such things. This is the doing of God, and we may say that they are manifestations of the Holy Ghost. And let's see a few verses in Acts 4:31. Acts 4:31 says, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with the boldness. So it's not the first experience, this is afterwards. So the Holy Ghost has given them boldness to preach the gospel in the midst of their enemies. They preached bold. Before they were afraid, they were hiding in the houses. Now they preach with boldness. This is the power which God gave. The power to do miracles and those kind of things, that's also one side. But this one is, this is more important. They give them boldness. They were even, did not hesitate to become a martyr. So in Acts chapter 19 verse 17, we see Ananias came to Saul. He said, Brother Saul, the Lord even Jesus has sent me that thou might receive the sight. He was blind as soon as God struck him, and to be filled with the Holy Ghost. In chapter 13, verse 9 to 12, same thing, Acts chapter 13, verses 9. Then Saul, who also is called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, set his eyes on him and said, O full of subtlety and all mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of righteous, see, the boldness, you confront this guy, and thou not cease to pervert the right way of the Lord. Verse 11, and now, behold, the hands of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. So the power of the Holy Ghost is in Paul, made the child of the devil blind. So these kind of things nowadays I don't think is happening, because I don't really explain why it is, because it's not like the old days. People are not zealous for him. They are not truthful. Even those operate, they are kind of wishy-washy. They don't risk their lives. So the dedication the power also less, because they don't have dedication to God, and they live a double life. So that's why these things are not happening. And then next, then we see the gift of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is giving the gifts to the people. At the same time, Jesus Christ also giving the spirits. Jesus Christ baptized them with the Holy Ghost. Then the Holy Ghost do the ministry, and Jesus Christ stays aside, and he is also behind it. They both are doing it. Jesus Christ baptizes. The Holy Ghost give the gifts. Say that is the ministry. Then Jesus Christ gives the Holy Spirit to people to live a holy life. Gifts and the Spirit are two different things, because Holy Ghost is giving the gifts and Jesus Christ is giving the Spirit. They're two different things. People may receive none of these two because they don't care for the Holy of God or something like that. They are going to the religion and going to the churches, those kind of things. They may not be even born again. They don't may have the Spirit at all. That is, they have nothing of these two. Or they may receive one of them or both of them. And it is good for them. In Acts chapter 2, verse 4, Acts chapter 2, verse 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So a lot of times, this is the controversial things, and I said, because some of the people speak in tongues, some of the people abuse the tongues. Those are, yeah, well, I say controversial, leave it at that. If we just read this verse, just to read these words, and we may see that we receive the gift of speaking in tongues, and so we speak in tongues. There's a gift, so I speak it, and we speak the tongues. That's what reading. That's all we get. But if we carefully study this verse, this one verse, and maybe with the other, with the light of the scripture, and we may notice one more thing. If you are born of the Spirit, then the Spirit receives the gift. Not the flesh, not me, but the Spirit is me. If I am born of the Spirit, then the Spirit is in me. And when this gift is given, the Spirit receives it, not me. You see, the Spirit is in me. So the Spirit receives the gifts and gives the utterance to me, to us. Then we speak. We speak. But there's another step in between. There's two steps. And Romans chapter 8, Romans, book of Romans, chapter 8, verse 26 says, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. The Spirit helpeth our infirmity. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. We cannot utter it in our fleshly effort. So the Spirit jump in and he utters that he helps us with the Spirit. Then 1 Corinthians chapter 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. First Corinthians chapter 14, verse 2 says, for he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God, for no man understandeth him. Howbeit, in the Spirit he speaketh mysteries. Jesus Christ gives us the Holy Spirit, as we're born again, and the Holy Ghost gives us the gift of speaking tongues. When we pray to God, both the gifts come to help us, to make us effective communication with God the Father. So it is important, both the Spirit as well as the gift, both are important. If we're born again, we have the Spirit, then the Spirit, the Holy Ghost give the gifts. So if you're born again, the Spirit, our flesh will speak the tongue, and the Holy Ghost give the gift, the tongues. The Spirit receives it, and it will give with groanings and with all the things what to speak and everything. Say, this is a hidden language or secret language by those two, by the Spirit, and that then that will be given through our tongues and we speak. But God hears that. So there's a communication, it's a strange communication, it's a spiritual communication. We cannot figure it out how. By faith we receive it and speak to God. And our attention, our attitude, our emotion, our feelings will be towards God. And we pray with tongues, with groaning. That is the Holy Ghost gives the utterance, and the Holy Spirit gives the groanings. And we, the persons, can pray in tongues, and God will answer our prayers. I don't know that I explained it enough or not. It's kind of hard to explain the spiritual things. Unless you feel it, then you'll know better. But still, I think I did okay. And this way, we can be in touch with God, or even be abide with God. So receive the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and abide with God. We'll be one with God. Thank you for listening. May God bless you. May His presence go with you. Amen.